morning we're going to talk about differential equations, do a little bit of review, and I'm going to let you do a little bit of practice on your own as well. So, one thing I've noticed my students having problems with is knowing when to do this. When do you know that the problem is a differential equation problem? So let's talk about how you can recognize it. First of all, you will see, and they usually show up in free response questions, the original equation of the problem will be dy dx equals something. If it starts out that way, and then it asks you, for example, to find a particular solution, that's going to be a differential equations process. We'll talk about that in a second. It may have a slope field. If you see a slope field, it is going to definitely be a differential equation problem. I will review how to do slope fields here in just a minute. Okay. It will, whenever you're given this, and it will almost always ask you for a particular solution. And it will usually say y equals f of x. And I'll talk a little bit more about that as to how the AP wants it when it says that. And it will give you an initial condition, which is basically an ordered pair to plug in to find your c value. Okay. Couple things you need to know. This is a very high point count type of problem in the AP exam world. You remember that you take 6 free response questions. Each one is worth 9 points. And the particular solution part of it can be worth between 5 and 6 points just by itself. So it is a very heavy point count type of problem. So if you know how to do this well, you can be guaranteed good points on this one question. Okay? Now, when it says y equals f of x in the problem, you must solve for y to get all the points. Now, when we do a problem, that'll make a little bit more sense. Because at some point, you may think, oh, I can just stop right here. No, you're going to have to go and solve for y. Sometimes it will ask you to state its domain, and it must be based on the initial condition, and I'll talk about that as well. So you're writing a lot of words down right now that don't make a problem, may not make a whole lot of sense, but they will once we do a problem. Okay. So when you see a problem that starts out dy dx equals something, your brain should go diffq, and I'm going to probably have to do finding a particular solution by separation of variables. All right? Okay, so I need to turn the page, and we're going to go to the back of this page. And we're going to together work through this first question, and then I'm actually going to give you some time to work through one yourself. Okay? Here is a typical DPQ question. This one was nice. It said the word differential equation in it. Thank you very much. Appreciate that. Satisfies the differential equation of this with an initial condition. Now, initial condition sometimes is written this way, but understand that that means the ordered pair 2 comma 1. Initial conditions are always ordered pairs, and what they are used for is when you take a differential equation, they're used to find the c value. Okay. Now, part A, sketch the slope field for the given differential equation at the 12 points indicated below. Now, notice there's only 12 dots. You don't have to do the ones on the x-axis. Okay. Now, for those of you who don't remember how to do this, what you do is you take every point on here and you plug it into this equation right here. Remember that dy dx means slope, so this is telling you the slope is equal to the x coordinate squared minus 1 divided by the y coordinate. Okay, so let's start. I like to start on the x and y axis, that's just me. So I'm going to write these down for a few, and then after that hopefully you can do these in your head. This point is 0, 1. So what we're going to do is plug in those ordered pairs into the slope. So the slope will be 0 squared minus 1 over 1. So that slope is what? -1. So what you do is at this point you're going to draw a small line segment with a slope of negative 1. I knew it was negative because it's leaning that way. And what I do is whenever I'm drawing these lines, well, okay, that slope would be up 1 and over 1. So I make it head towards this other point that if I drew the entire line, that's what it would be touching. Okay. So 1, 1 would be the next point. So the slope would be 1 squared minus 1 over 1, which is what? 0. How does a line segment look with a slope of 0? It's just flat. So this one is flat right there. Do you see the procedure that I'm going through to do these? Okay, let's just do one more and then we'll move on to the rest. I don't want to spend the whole time doing this. Let's do 2. Let's go up to 2, 2. Just kind of skip around a little bit. That's this point right there. So that would be 2 squared minus 1 over 2. So 4 minus 1 is 3 halves. So that's kind of, you're going to have to kind of eyeball it. Up 3 over 2, it's kind of steep. So something like that, and that's positive slope. Now, several years ago, this was a common AP question. They would just give you, say, fill in slope yield. In the last few years, they haven't had many of them that they want you to construct. What they have had is answering questions about slope yields, and there's a couple more in here, I think, that we can look at. All right. Now, the next question here says, find f double prime of 2. Okay. Does anybody have an idea of what I need to do with this in order to find f double prime? I'm going to take the second derivative of this problem. So I'm going to come down here. So the original equation, dy dx equals x squared minus 1 over y. How do I need to take the derivative of this thing? What rule do I need to use? I need to use quotient rule on this one. So remember that second derivative is written this way, d squared y over dx squared. The reason it's not dy dx squared is because that means square the derivative. It doesn't mean second derivative. Okay, so we have to do low d high to this. So low is y, d high is 2x minus x squared minus 1 times, what is the derivative of y? 1 dy dx. Because you're taking the derivative of a y, you have to use dy dx. So dy dx goes right there over y squared. Don't forget to sign in and get yourself a handout. Okay. Now, always look back at the problem. If they give you a point, again, don't worry about cleaning this up too much. Go ahead and plug the point in now. So we're going to have f double prime of 2 would equal, hey, I got a problem though. This says f double prime of 2. Is that 2 an x or a y value? It's an x value. So how do I know what its y value is? What'd you say, Abby? It's 1. How'd you know that? It tells you right there. Oh, okay. They'll never give you anything that you can't solve for. It's in there somewhere. So we're plugging in the point 2 comma 1. So 1 times 2 times 2 minus 2 squared minus 1 times, ooh, dy dx. How am I going to get that? I could plug it into this. So this would be, so 2 squared minus 1 over 1, because remember it's the point 2 comma 1. So 4 minus 1 is 3 over 1, so this is 3. Did everybody follow what I just did? And then over y, 1 squared. And now it's just cleanup. So 1 times 4 is 4 minus 2 squared is 4 minus 1 is 3 times 3 is 9 over 1. And negative 5 is my answer. Any questions? So far, so good? Okay. All right, letter C. It says use separation of variables to find an expression for f of x. This also implies to solve for y. Solve for y. Because f of x is a function, so that means it's got to be a y equals situation. Okay? So now, I need to take this function right here, dy dx equals x squared minus 1 over y, and I need to basically work it backwards. What we are doing is backwards implicit differentiation. We talked about implicit differentiation the other day if you were here, but this is taking an answer from implicit and going backwards. Okay. These are always done with the same steps, and I'll talk about where the points are handed out when you do this. The first thing you're going to do is separate the variables, like it says, x's and y's. I recommend always move the denominator's label over. If this had been a dt, you move it over. I don't care what it is, but if it's on the bottom, it needs to move over. Okay? So that's step one. Step two, well, we're not done yet. What else? What's on the wrong side of the problem here if I'm trying to separate the variables? Y. Do I move it by multiplying or dividing? Multiplying. So if I multiply both sides by y, this will be y dy equals x squared minus 1 dx. That's a point right there on the AP exam, being able to do that properly. Okay? The next step is what? Those of you guys have all had this before. What do we do? Integral on both sides. So draw your integral symbols on both sides. The integral of y dy is 1 half y squared. We don't put a plus c on that side. We combine them together on the other side into one single constant. And then x squared would be 1 third x to the third minus the antiderivative of 1 is x, and then a plus c. So you get 1 point for doing both of these antiderivatives correctly and 1 point for writing plus c. Just for writing plus c, you get a point, which is kind of nice. But I have still seen kids today who forget to write the plus c down. But if you don't have the plus c, you have nothing to plug your point in. You have nothing to plug in your ordered pair. Hey, come sign in and grab a handout. Yes?
Do you always have to put the plus c on the x, like with the x's?
You don't. No, you don't. Usually it's with the independent variable, whatever the independent variable is. It's just because eventually I'm going to have to solve for y. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot easier if it's on that other side. Otherwise, I'm going to have to move it over. You can put it on either side you want to. It's a good question. Okay. So 3 points already gathered right there just by doing that much. Okay. This is the general solution. And they say they want you to find an expression for f of x, which means I need to get rid of c by plugging in the point 2 comma 1. That's why they gave me that initial condition. Now, you have a couple choices. You can plug it in right now. You can clean it up a little bit first. It doesn't matter. I'm going to go ahead and plug it in right now. So 1 half of 1 squared equals 1 third of 2 to the third minus 2 plus c. So 1 half of 1 squared is 1 half equals 2 to the third is 8. So this is 8 thirds minus 2 plus c. So I'm going to have to get common denominators here. So that would be 3 over 6 equals 16 over 6 minus 12 over 6 plus c. Watch my math because this is my weak area. 3, 6 equals 4, 6 plus c. So c equals negative 1, 6. Do you all agree with me? Am I doing my math right? Please check me. Okay, here's the next point, getting the correct c value. Okay, now once you know what c is, go back to right before you plugged in the values for x and y. Rewrite the equation. 1 half y squared equals 1 third x to the third minus x minus 1 sixth. But because it says write an expression for f of x, that means I must solve this for y. That is an equation, yes, but it's not a function, okay? So, first thing we need to do, multiply 3 by the common denominator, which is 6. Actually, we could multiply, yeah, let's do that. Multiply both sides by 2, that'd be just as easy. So let's do that. So times 2 to both sides. Y squared equals 2/3 x to the third minus 2x minus 1/3. Did I do that right? Yep. Okay. Now to solve for y, I need to do what? Square root both sides. So y equals plus or minus the square root of 2/3 x to the third minus 2x minus 1/3. Okay. That looks great. But you know what? You will not get the final point yet. And here's why. This right here is not a function. A plus or minus gives you the top and the bottom half of a function, which makes it not a function because it won't pass the vertical line test. So, how do you know which one to choose? You must make a decision. Is it the positive square root or the negative square root?
So, because
you have to look at the initial condition to decide. The initial condition was the point 2 comma 1. So you've got to ask yourself, if I plug in 2, I know the mathematically it's going to come out to be a 1 inside the radical. So which square root do I need so that I get a positive answer? Well, I need the positive square root. So the final answer is y equals the square root of 2/3 x to the third minus 2x minus 1/3. And then you would get your final point right there. Okay. So, over 50% of the point count is right there in that last procedure, separating variables. Okay? Any questions? Okay, turn the page over. There's almost a problem identical to it right there on the top of the next page. I want you to try a couple points on the slope field and then answer the other two questions. I'm more focused than anything on the separation of variables at the end. So read through that, do a couple of the slope field points, and then do the rest of the problem.
Would you put the slope?
Very good question. Very good question. If it comes out as undefined, so where it's like a number over 0, you will put a vertical line. Oh, you can't see what I'm writing, sorry. If it comes out as like a number over 0, as undefined slope, you put a vertical line segment. If it comes out as 0 over 0, you put nothing. You leave it blank. Because 0 over 0 is indeterminate, remember? It could equal 1, it could equal 5, it could equal 9. You don't know, so you leave it blank. So if it's a number over 0, you put a vertical line. That's not equal to 1.
Wait, what about 0 over a number?
0 over a number, that would be a horizontal line because the slope is 0. Does anybody have an answer for B? Young, go for it. What do you say?
I thought that like the slope field doesn't give it, the graph that they give you in B, it requires kind of like the same slope, like same but like negative version of the slope at like past the origin. That makes sense. Like the y line kind of reflects the slope in like the positive and negative direction.
Right.
So I thought that the slope probably shows that even at like the y axis, the slope isn't necessarily the same throughout the whole thing. So it won't be like,
I know what you're saying, but what did you write down? Tell me what you wrote down.
I kind of linked it. I wrote the slope field indicates that the slopes on either side of the y-axis are not negative equal values. So in the graph shown with the same value, you get different signs.
Okay. I kind of understand what you're saying. I'm thinking as a grader, okay? I kind of understand what you're saying, but when you say y values, what do you mean by that?
Negative equal values.
Negative equal, that, yeah, to me that's unclear.
Okay.
I would say like opposite, you know, opposite slopes or something along that line. Okay, but I understand what you're trying to say. What did you write?
I said the graph would be more like an elips than a parabola.
Okay. That's good, but I don't think they would give you the credit for that because you need a little more detail as to what specifically about it is showing you that it's elliptical. Anybody else want to tell me what they wrote? Okay. Here's the thing that sticks out for me, and this is something that's a good skill, especially if they give you a slope field and ask you which of the following equations could it be. Always look for where the slope is zero. It's very obvious to tell. Do you really know what the slope is right there? You know it's positive, but you're not sure what. But right there, that's pretty darn guaranteed that the slope is zero, okay? So, remember that a particular solution that is a graph can be drawn on a slope field at any height along the graph, because when you add a number to the end of an equation, what does it do to the graph of that equation? It moves it up or down, okay? So all a plus c does is take your graph and move it up and down. It will never move it side to side, okay? So the slope field has got to match this graph no matter what height I'm at. So in order for this to be the correct answer, I have to have a slope of zero where? At the origin or anywhere along the y-axis. Does that make sense? This has a slope of c about 2, okay? In order for this to be one of the solutions, all of these points along the y-axis have to have a slope of zero. Does that make sense? Okay, that's one reason why it wouldn't work. You could say this, something to this effect. In order for this graph to be a solution, the slopes all along the y-axis must be zero, and the slope field shows they are not. The slope field shows they are not. Okay, you've got to talk about some specific slope. Young, yours was good. They would debate it, but I think they probably would give you credit for that. But what he was saying was the slopes are opposites on either side of the y-axis. You know, if this is a positive slope, this is a negative slope. That's another thing, too. In quadrant one, the slopes here are negative. Are the slopes in quadrant one negative here? No, they're not. They're positive. So that's another reason why it doesn't work. You could say something about that. But you got to talk about the slopes. How are the slopes not working? Okay, now I worked out letter C while you guys were working. Would I get all the points for this answer right here? No. Would I get most of the points for this answer? Now, did anybody when they were working multiply through by 2 before they solved for C? Because you can do that. Did you get the same C value I did here? You did? Okay. Because if you multiplied through by 2 beforehand, your C value in the very end should be negative 8. Was yours negative 8 at the very end? Oh, yes. Okay, yes. There is a way I can see where it would work that way. When I teach my kids to multiply through by 2, this C does not become 2C. It becomes C again. It just becomes another C, which made C would be negative 8. Okay. So this is not done. Which square root should I use for the negative? Negative this time because of the negative 4. Yes? Because if this is, when you draw a curve through a slope field, it has to match the slopes of this. It has to be positive slopes, then a slope of 0, and then negative slopes. Either right there, or this one, or this one, or this one, or this one.
You don't know whether it's translated up or down.
Correct. Correct. Okay. Questions on that? Some people are writing, so I'm going to give them a second to write. All right. How do you feel about this differential equation stuff? Pretty good? Okay. I had a feeling that you would, and so I have a little bit more in this packet. Let me show you what else is here if you want to practice. So I'm going to turn the page. Kind of bled through a little bit. Those of you in AB might recognize this question. We did a question like this on a test, I believe, or in a worksheet. We're not going to work through this, but let me show you how you know this is a differential equations question. It said, let V of t be the velocity in feet per second of a skydiver at time t seconds. After her parachute opens, her velocity satisfies. Oh, they said differential equations. They're so nice. Even if they didn't say differential equations, you should know right there, because it says dv dt equals, this is a differential equation problem. Okay? This is nice because it says use separation of variables. They don't do that much on the AP exam anymore. This is out of a practice book. This is not off the exam itself. So you won't necessarily get the prompt to know what to do. It says find the velocity in terms of t. Okay? And then this one is asking you a limit question, finding the terminal velocity. And then it is safe to land when her speed is 20. At what time t does she reach the speed? But it tells you right up here to find an expression for v in terms of t. And that's your separation of variables again. Okay, turn the page. Here's another one. This is off the 2006 exam. Okay, I want to just briefly start the separation of variables because in this case something unusual happens, just to make sure we're all on the same page. Okay, so part B, we have the function dy dx equals 1 plus y over x is our differential equation. Okay, so let's start separating variables. Dx goes there. Okay, be very careful. The 1 plus y, when it moves to the other side, goes to the denominator. So it is 1 over 1 plus y dy equals what on the other side? Dx over x. You can write it that way, or you can write it as 1 over x dx. So this time, unlike the other two, the x's and y's are in the denominator. You got to be very, very careful. Okay? So the next step, of course, is integrating. Let's tackle the right side first. What's the integral of dx over x? Ln absolute value of x plus c. That's easy enough. Okay. What is this? Is this ln of 1 plus y? Maybe. Maybe. Okay. Now, what is the power? How do you know if it's ln or not? That's a good question. It's du over if u. If the denominator's power is 1, it's ln. Okay? However, if what is down here is more than just a y or an x or a t or something along those lines, you better either mentally or on paper do a u-substitution to make sure you don't miss anything. Are you following what I'm saying? Because if this had said 1 plus 2y or 1 plus 9y, it's not necessarily going to be a straight ln. You've got to be sure. Okay? I'm going to write it out for those who need it on paper. Some of you can do it in your head, and that's fine. So, u equals the denominator, 1 plus y. I know I'm leaning towards ln, but I got to make sure that I'm not missing any numbers when I do this. So, what is the derivative of 1 plus y? It's just 1, right? So du is just equal to dy. Now I'm safe. I know for a fact that I'm okay to say that that's a straight ln. I don't need to include any more numbers. I can just say this is ln of 1 plus y, like so. Okay. What would the derivative have been if it had said d, if u was 1 plus 2y? This du would have been 2dy, which means you would have needed to put a 2 in there and a 1 half outside. Okay. Now, some of you are going, ugh, u substitution. That's the next thing I'm going to talk about. Okay. Because I know some of you are still going, I don't know when I'm supposed to do it. We did a whole page of practice on regular integrals, and we did a whole page of practice on u-substitution. We never really mixed them together. When do you do it? When do you not? I've come up with a way to help you with that. Okay, now, I need to solve for y. Now, you can plug in your points right now if you want to, but I think it's better to get the y by itself first when it deals with ln's. How do you get an ln off of something? E to the, raise it to the power of e. So that goes like that. E to the ln of 1 plus y is 1 plus y. Okay, remember that you need to break this apart. This is e to the ln of x times e to the c. And e to the constant is just another constant. So So 1 plus y equals c e to the ln of x is what? What is e to the ln of x? Just x. So it's c times x. Okay. So, is that done? No. Did it tell me what I'm supposed to plug in to find C? Go back and look for it. They'll always give it to you. Here it is right here. 1 plus 1 equals, I don't know why my brain just all of a sudden decided to go into neutral. So C equals negative 2. You agree? So the equation is 1 plus y equals negative 2x. Y equals negative 2x minus 1. Okay. Now, it says in state its domain. And I need to talk about that. Because that looks like the domain is just negative infinity to infinity because it's the line. But the slope field we skipped tells us otherwise. Okay? If I plug 1, 0 into here, what's the slope going to be? 1. 2, 0 is going to give me 1 half, which is flatter. 1, 1 is going to give me 2. 0, I know it didn't ask for it there. 1, negative 1, let's see. That's going to be 0. Negative 1, 0 would be negative 1. Negative 1, 1 is, I can't do mental math. It hurts my brain. Negative 2. Negative 1 is 0 again. And negative 2. Negative 2. 0 will be negative 1 half. Okay, what is 0, 0? I don't know why they left these off, because these are important. 0, 0 would be straight up and down. Agreed? Wouldn't 0, 0 be straight up and down? What about 0, 1? Straight up and down. 0, negative 1. Straight. Any time when you draw a slope field or you look at a slope field, if you see the little line segments lining up like these, this is an asymptote. For any curve that you draw in there, it is an asymptote. You cannot cross it. Okay? Now, the point in question was negative 1, 1, right there. Okay, look at what answer we got here, negative 2x minus 1. We figured out that the slope of that was negative 2. Now, if we continued that line down, do you think we'd hit negative 1 as a y-intercept? Probably so. But I cannot cross this line because it is a boundary. So if I have to go through this point, what is the domain going to be for this function? The domain is going to be negative infinity to 0. Think about that for a minute. Do you understand why? It can only be on this side of the graph. Yes, sir.
If you were going to find the domain algebraically, like say it didn't give you anything, is that when the x value fails?
Yes, it's where the x value would fail.
Okay. And then for range, it'd be where the y value fails?
No, it has to be based on where. What values y would give you based on the x's that you're defined. We're never going to see that on the AP exam. That's a pre-AP skill. They used to do that, but not anymore. It doesn't really, we got calculators now. We really don't have to calculate domains and ranges. We can just look at the graph and figure it out.
Okay, the only reason they ask you is the slope.
But this is because of the fact that the slope field has a asymptote in it. Okay? Any questions on that domain thing? Because that's a point right there. That's a, like a 6 point. It's finding the domain.
So why do you know that it can't be on the right side?
Because it told me I have to go through the point negative 1, 1. Because the initial condition was negative 1, 1, that means I have to go through this point. So I know for a fact it's going to be on the left. It might be on the right, but I'm not sure. So I can only limit my domain to be what I'm sure of. Okay. That make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else? Okay. Real quickly, I know we're almost out of time. I have on here the next two pages are titled integrals. And I want to go back to the front and talk a little bit about u-substitution, because that's what this is really doing. I know I have a haunted door. I did this with my kids a few days ago, and it doesn't hurt to do it again. How do you know when you have to do a u-substitution? Okay. I'm just going to put a few problems on here. Let's see. Boy, it's not easy to make these up. Okay, I'll give you a second to copy those four down. These are potential. Do I need u substitution or not? All right, there are two tests that you can give to a problem to see if you need a u substitution. Test number one, I call the chain rule test. This is Miss Bell's method for finding u substitution. This isn't published anywhere. It just is what I came up with. The chain rule test, okay? What I want you to do is to look at a problem. Look at the inside of the problem. Forget about the integral. Let's take this first one. If you were to take the derivative of this, would you have to use the chain rule? Yes, you would, because you would copy and paste the e to the 2x minus 3 times the 2, okay? If you would have to take... the derivative using the chain rule, you have to use a u substitution to do the antiderivative, okay? If you need the chain rule to do the derivative, you need a u substitution to do the antiderivative. You need a chain rule to do the do the derivative. You need a u substitution to do the antiderivative. So this is yes, you need the chain rule for that one. Yes, you need a u substitution for that one. Okay. What would u be? Just the inner function. So when you get to the point where you're looking at it going, okay, I know I need a chain rule, but what do I use for u? U is always the inner function, whatever's on the inside of the other one. Okay? All right. Those are situations where you only see one x in the problem. That's only got one x in the problem. Okay. This is the multiple x test, I guess you can call it, is the second rule. If there are x's multiplied or divided, not added and subtracted, just multiplied and divided, and you cannot combine them, you need a u substitution. I see lots of x's in this problem. Are any of them multiplied or divided? Yes. I have some that are added and subtracted, but that's not the point. Can I combine those x's together?
Yes.
No. So this one does need a u substitution. I'm going to throw one more problem at the bottom. That one kind of looks like it needs a u substitution, but it really doesn't. Because even though those x's are divided, I can combine them. Do you see how I can combine them? You break it into two separate fractions. So this would be x squared over x minus 5 over x. So now I just have x minus 5 over x. And now the x's are just added, subtracted, and you're okay. If they're only added and subtracted, you can just integrate. Just go to town. So this is a no, doesn't need one. This is a yes, it does. Any guess as to which part of the fraction is u? Bottom. Du will never be on the bottom. U is always the bottom. So u in this case would be 5 halves x minus 4 x plus 2. So let's just go a step further. What is du? What's the derivative of that? 5x minus 4 dx. Do I have all that? Yeah. So this is a situation of du over u, isn't it? It's an ln problem.
So is u always going to be on the denominator?
If there is a fraction, u is it, okay, and both the powers are the same, u is going to be the denominator. Okay? All right. Those are the only two tests there are. So, do I have two x's that are divided or multiplied? Yes. Can I combine them? Not really. So what do you think u would be here? Sine of x. Use the bottom. Always use the bottom. Du would be cosine of x, right? Are you all with me? So what is this in terms of u? The numerator is your du, the denominator is your u, and once again, that's an ln problem. Okay? Please ask.
Okay, so I understand what you do for du over u, but like, what do you do after that? Like, why are you doing du over u?
Okay.
Do you
No. The reason I have to do this is because there is a rule that tells me what this antiderivative is. This is an ln problem. So. This would be ln of the absolute value of u plus c, and then you change it back to x's. So this would be ln of the absolute value of sine of x plus c. That's its antiderivative.
So you do that to find the antiderivative?
Correct. Okay. That's what I'm doing, is finding the antiderivative. Okay, what about this one? Do I need a u substitution or not? Abby's shaking her head no. Okay, can I make, if there are x's that are multiplied and divided, which there are, that I cannot combine, can I combine those together? Yes, I can do some simple math to that, can't I? So this would be the integral of x cubed minus 4x squared dx. Agreed? So are they multiplied or divided anymore? No, they're just add and subtracted. So now I can just integrate it. Just do it normally. Are you all with me on this one? So this is a no. I don't need a u substitution for that. Yes?
Even if you don't need to, technically, can you like do it all the time?
Not all the time. Sometimes, yes. There are some questions where you could do it and it wouldn't hurt you, but there are some questions that you'll end up in a corner and you can't go anywhere if you do a u substitution.
Okay?
Faria. I can multiply x squared and x here. If I had a problem that, let me see. Look at this one. Okay, how difficult would it be to multiply that x to that x squared with that power? It would be extremely ugly. So here's a multiplication situation where I can't really combine the x's. So I need a u substitution here. Okay, this is a good one to do. What is u? X squared minus 3. Agreed? So what is du? 2x dx. How did I know it was x squared minus 3? It's another inner function. It's kind of back to the chain rule as well. Okay. Do I have 2x and dx? I have the x, but I don't have the 2. So 2 goes there, 1 half goes there. Some of you are taught to divide both sides to get the dx by itself. Or du divided by 2, that works too. So this is 1 half integral. This and this is du, and so this is u to the fourth. So this would be 1 half and then 1 fifth u to the fifth plus c, which is 1 tenth x squared minus 3 to the fifth plus c, and that's your final answer. Okay, the last two pages of this packet are more practice on u-substitution.